Just ahead on One Detroit. Lawmakers in Lansing take action on several bills. We'll tell you about some of the new laws passed by the legislature. Plus, a future of work conversation on the growing role of Generation X in the workplace. Also ahead, the Alvin Ailey American Dance Theater's Younger Dance Company gives lessons to aspiring dancers in Detroit public schools. And we'll give you some ideas on what you can do this weekend in Metro Detroit. It's all coming up next on One Detroit.
From Delta faucets to Behr paint, Masco Corporation is proud to deliver products that enhance the way consumers all over the world experience and enjoy their living spaces. Masco, serving Michigan communities since 1929. Support for this program is provided by the Cynthia and Essel Ford Fund for Journalism at Detroit Public TV, the Kresge Foundation.
The DTE Foundation is a proud sponsor of Detroit Public TV, among the state's largest foundations committed to Michigan-focused giving. We support organizations that are doing exceptional work in our state. Visit dtefoundation.com to learn more.
Nissan Foundation and viewers like you.
Just ahead on this week's One Detroit. Our Future of Work initiative takes a look at how Gen Xers are taking on leadership roles in the workforce and shaping future office trends. Plus, the young dancers in Alvin Ailey's performing company, Ailey 2, make a stop at a Detroit high school to meet and train students. And One Detroit contributors Peter Whorf and Dave Wagner of 90.9 WRCJ offer up a list of things to do in Metro Detroit this weekend and beyond. But first up, there has been a lot of legislative action taking place in Lansing over the past few weeks. On Thursday, Governor Whitmer signed an expansion of the Elliot Larson Civil Rights Act that includes protections for the LGBTQ community. This comes after lawmakers passed bills on issues including guns and right to work. One Detroit's Bill Kubota got the rundown from Michigan Radio's political director, Zoe Clark.
Another rally about guns at the state capitol this week. Hundreds came. Detroiters, Spartans, the governor.
We are done only offering thoughts and prayers. It is time for action.
It is so difficult because it is not the natural order of life. We are not supposed to be burying our children.
I will not comply.
A few here protesting the protesters and the keynote speaker, former Arizona Congresswoman Gabby Giffords, still recovering from a gunshot to the head in a mass shooting where six others were killed in 2011.
But change doesn't happen overnight. I can't do it alone. Join me. Let's move ahead together. Amen.
But now, Michigan gun laws really expected to change. Other laws, too, spinning out of a whirlwind Wednesday House session last week. Elliot Larson, right to work. We'll talk about those, but first, background checks for gun purchases.
Simply put, this bill is a slippery slope towards oppressive, authoritative government. Or should I say even more oppressive, authoritative government. This package will not take anything away from gun owners. It will merely be an inconvenience to you. The same way you inconvenience my curriculum so I can teach my kids survival. A required background check, much like every parent who comes into my classroom has to have to read to my students.
State Rep Jamie Churches, she was a teacher downriver. She introduced a gun bill that passed in a vote split along party lines. The recent shootings at nearby Michigan State University activating legislators.
For a lot of lawmakers, it was personal.
So many connections to MSU. Here's Zoe Clark, Michigan Radio's political director.
That can be frustrating for some people that it takes something personal to get something done. They definitely moved gun safety legislation forward on the calendar.
The bill is passed.
Well, what was the problem that the Republicans had with that?
Well, look, I mean, I don't want to just make it all about Democrats versus Republicans, but Democrats want some gun safety legislation that they've been pushing for, and Republicans tend to be Second Amendment, and they say it's not about gun safety legislation, this is a mental health crisis. And Democrats, at least these bills that have been pushed so far, these three, right, that many folks say actually can be helpful if you look at the data across the country, and this is safe storage laws, red flag laws, universal background checks. What we know about Michigan voters is, in recent polling, it shows that actually a majority of Michigan voters approve of these three pieces of legislation that they're pushing.
Senate Bill number 04, a bill to amend the Elliott-Larsen Civil Rights Act.
Elliott-Larsen dates back to 1977, protecting Michiganders from discrimination, but not LGBT people. Not till last year when the state Supreme Court decided that it does. But there's no guarantee that ruling can't be overturned, thus the amendment.
I also rise today as the first out queer woman to serve in the Michigan legislature. But I do just want to note that a few months ago, I was prohibited from even making that statement in this chamber. And I'm grateful that the landscape has shifted dramatically.
We're often accused of having a secret agenda. The truth is, the only agenda I have is to live my life free from discrimination and hate.
Many religious individuals and organizations hold deeply held beliefs about sexuality and gender. Forcing them to act in a way that goes against their beliefs is a violation of their religious freedom.
To all those who would invoke the word of the Lord to deny us these rights, I remind you, the Lord created us in his own image. Can you not see the Lord in me? Can you not see the Lord in your gay sons and daughters, brothers and sisters, nieces and nephews? Can you not see the Lord in us?
This legislation will show LGBTQ people, particularly LGBTQ people of color, that they can fulfill their full aspirations. Your identity won't limit who you are or what you can do. You don't have to hide anymore. You don't have to feel less than. And that is cause for celebration.
Bipartisan support. 8 House Republicans voted for the amendment.
The bill is passed.
I wonder if some of the talk on the floor by some of the representatives changed some minds.
I don't know how much of it changed minds versus what we know is there were probably some Republican lawmakers even in previous sessions that would have voted for it, but it never actually came to the House or the Senate floor because Republicans were in charge and didn't ever put it up for a vote.
Now, the governor's locked the Elliott-Larsen Amendment into state law.
The third big one I'd like to talk about kind of started in 2012. And that's right to work.
Yeah.
What happened there?
Oh, my goodness. So let's go back 10 years ago this past December. This is legislative Republicans pushed forward right to work in an incredible short amount of time. Rick Snyder, then governor Republican, basically said it wasn't on his agenda. This wasn't necessarily something he wanted to do. He believed it was divisive. But he ended up signing it into law, and there were huge protests at the state capitol.
Less commotion last Wednesday as the script was flipped, voting along party lines.
The so-called right-to-work law was designed not to give workers freedom, but to weaken their bargaining power and increase the profits of a few.
Many companies look solely to right-to-work states, and this is one of those major factors in determining whether we're going to land a major economic opportunity for our state.
Right-to-work was never about freedom. It was simply about control. Dr. Martin Luther King knew that truth all the way back in 1961 when he said, "In our glorious fight for civil rights, we must guard against being fooled by false slogans such as right to work."
Wednesday, I mean, that movie, Everything Everywhere All at Once, you know, winning all of the Oscars. I mean, it felt a little like that in Lansing last Wednesday. It really was just the way that the votes happened so quickly. It had a lot of folks head spinning. And what Democrats are saying is like, look, this is what we said we were going to do.
What does the future of work look like for Generation X? That was the focus of our recent virtual town hall titled Gen X, Picking Up the Slack in an Evolving Workforce. I spoke with Michigan Works Association CEO Ryan Hundt about workforce trends involving Generation X and their growing responsibilities as baby boomers retire. Here's a portion of that conversation.
Right. Ryan, let's just jump right in. Let's set the table. What is the workforce landscape right now for someone who's a Gen Xer? You know, are they, what level of job are they holding? What's the next step for them in the workforce? Tell me a little bit about that.
First and foremost, I'd like to talk about some trends that we're seeing right now in the workforce. Just a few years ago, millennials surpassed Gen Xers as the largest generation in workforce in terms of just the sheer volume of workers that are currently engaged in the workforce in 2023. And with baby boomers either having retired or staring down retirement themselves, there's plenty of older Gen Xers who are also kind of following suit with those baby boomers. Maybe they're preparing for retirement themselves. We know that for the most part, Gen Xers will be in the workforce again for the next 10 to 30 years. We need to make sure that they are continuing to have a significant impact in the workforce. Of course, they certainly are. Gen Xers are now also entering their prime income ages. We know that typically the age 45 to 54 in the United States is typically the age demographic that sees the largest growth in terms of potential earnings over the course of that time period. So many of are either entering or have entered that prime income age as we speak. In addition to entering their prime income age, they're also making up the majority of leadership positions across the workforce. That's not just here in Michigan or in the United States, but globally, Gen Xers make up about 51% of leaders in organizations with an average of about 20 years of work experience. So they've certainly followed that natural progression of going from entry-level positions all the way up through, you know, middle management, now into upper-level management and leadership positions in both the public and private sector.
And how valuable are Gen Xers with that breadth of experience in the workforce already going to be for, you know, any kind of organization or company going into the future? Because, you know, they're taking up the mantle for boomers, but they just have so much more experience than a lot of millennials do.
Really, they are kind of that forgotten middle child between the baby boomer generation and the millennials. That's just not my take. You know, it's not me speaking, you know, on my own personal opinions, but I'd let the data speak for itself. Over the last several years, we've seen Gen Xers with an average promotion of only 1.2 promotions over a five-year period. That's lower than both millennials and baby boomers.
What does Michigan need to be doing to make, you know, jobs themselves, the work itself, more attractive to get people to come here?
Some things that Michigan can do, and I think Michigan does do quite well, and we just really need to double down on those efforts, is accentuating those positive attributes of our state. Many people may not know if they live outside of the Midwest, but Michigan has the largest shoreline of fresh water in the country. And we certainly look at our wonderful assets, and our natural beauty is on par with other parts of the state or other parts of the country and other parts of the globe, quite frankly. So for folks that are looking for that live, work, play aspect, where you're never too far away from some of those outdoor amenities, but we also have a number of cultural assets that we continue to highlight, institutions of higher learning for folks like myself who are big sports fans, big professional sports teams like the Red Wings and the Tigers, the Lions and the Pistons. Those are all key attributes that we just need to continue highlighting to folks that live outside of Michigan, not just to come here to tour the state, but hopefully come here and relocate to the state so that we can continue to grow in population in the coming years.
If we do have, you know, a perfect marketing campaign, Pure Michigan is a global phenomenon. It goes viral. All the right things happen for us in the right ways. Are we ready as a state infrastructurally to handle an influx in population and people like that? Do we have the jobs? Do we have the amenities? Do we have the things that we need to get what we're asking for?
We certainly have the jobs. I don't think that's the issue here. We have an average of about 500,000 job openings in Michigan. And similar to many other parts of the country, there's way more job openings compared to the number of individuals searching for jobs. So the jobs are certainly here. We would certainly encourage anybody that is interested in looking for their next professional journey to take a look at Michigan. We have a range of occupations and industries that are hiring, from advanced manufacturing to IT to healthcare. The jobs are certainly there. I think the infrastructure largely is there, and we are seeing some significant investments that have been outlined, perhaps, you know, for example, in the governor's executive budget recommendations on advancing some objectives and investments into affordable housing, because that is always a concern, not just in Michigan, but across the country. If we have workers come in, we need to make sure that they have places where they can live that are affordable, that are not outside of their reach for the salaries or wages that they are currently receiving. So that's all very positive news from an infrastructure standpoint. And of course, as I've mentioned here before on this chat today, the cultural amenities, the natural assets are certainly all there as well. I think Michigan is primed for a very significant comeback in terms of population increases over the next few decades. I'm super bullish on our prospects as a state to reap the benefits of relocations from individuals that might be seeking a new opportunity in a climate like Michigan's that is very favorable toward that growth.
And make sure to join me next Wednesday, March 22nd at noon for our next Future of Work virtual town hall, Millennials on the Move, Making Michigan Home, streaming live on One Detroit's Facebook page. Let's turn now to a special Detroit visit by the Alvin Ailey American Dance Theater's company of younger dancers and emerging choreographers known as Ailey 2. The group combines touring with community outreach and training. One Detroit contributing producer, Daijah Moss, was at the Ailey 2 workshop for students at Detroit School of Arts.
Our job at Ailey 2 is to bridge the students to becoming professional artists. So we take the most talented artists from the school and we nurture them, we give them professional habits so they can either join the main company or join another professional company after they're finished. I work in conjunction also with Robert Battle because we are connected as artistic director of Ailey 2 and he's the artistic director of Ailey 1. Like we talk and exchange ideas and think about also too the cohesion of the whole organization. What's really exciting about us being here, we're not only at DSA, but we're also branching out and extending our outreach to high schools around the area, the Detroit area. We're doing a series of workshops and master classes. And what's so exciting about what we've prepared for DSA is that the dancers from the company are actually become the leaders for the week. So they are going and they are teaching classes.
It's going to be a traditional warm-up and some modern and contemporary warming up, just to introduce a little bit of the essence of what we do in our typical day. But we're also going to be doing some across the floor, introducing some of our repertory. In conjunction with that, we're also on stage doing the actual meat of the work, which is live performances. And from then on, being able to bring students to those performances and interact with them after the performances. The Ailey Company as a whole has a wider umbrella, a wider range in its vastness of who it reaches, but Ailey 2 really has the ability to do the microscoping, the micro chisel of shaping young lives, being in schools personally.
I would have never thought I'd be able to say that I'd ever get to work with Alvin Ailey. That is something that it really does remind me that this is a cause completely bigger than me.
One of the things that's important to me, and I talked about coming into the job, is legacy shaping the future. To witness growth and witness these young artists feeling more confident within themselves, to feel empowered, to feel nuanced, to feel graceful, to feel full, fully expressive, is just, it's the most wonderful experience for me. We don't always get to express ourselves fully in the world that we feel when we experience racism or we experience inequity. So to have a space that we can pour all of that truth into the work and have other people see it and experience it, it changes lives. We have people all the time that have seen our performances and then it's pivoted them into another direction and to a courageous direction.
I credit Wade in the Water. It's me being here. I watched Wade in the Water actually in junior high school. It was part of our Black History Month dance history lesson, that segment that month. And I saw these beautiful black movers who looked like me, but me exemplified, magnified. So I felt that I was always a petite little one in class, but then to see someone who was of my size, it was a small black woman moving as the Wade girl, but to see her move in her power inspired me to find that kind of grace and elegance and maximize my voice in this world.
It was like the breakdown of like how the choir goes, "Wash the winds away, hallelujah, here I am." Like they have like a little like praising moment. When I saw the dancers do that, I was like, and that moment of energy where it was like you have these dramatic pauses and then like the breakdown happened. And that moment opened my eyes, honestly, as a dancer. I'd never seen people have so much fun on stage like that. Like having moments of intimacy with other dancers, that's the biggest part of it all.
We're called as artists to reach the human spirit and be a mirror to the human spirit. I think that we have the ability to heal, to empower, to uplift. So I'm able to connect with young people, the old generation, like we're all one community, and I'm able to see a wide range of ages, and that's the meat of what Ailey 2 is doing.
The stage is a social platform for change. There is power in the collective consciousness that is exchanged between an audience and dancers that are watching. Alvin would be so proud to think about what he started and the power of art and this seed that has now expanded into this moment of full recognition and inclusion is probably beyond what he dreamt.
By the way, you can see the world-renowned Alvin Ailey American Dance Theater perform at the Detroit Opera House from March 17th to the 19th. There are also a lot of other events and activities in the Detroit area this weekend and beyond. Peter Whorf and Dave Wagner from 90.9 WRCJ offer their suggestions in today's One Detroit Weekend.
Dave, there's a lot of fun things happening in the city this weekend and beyond for people to check out. What should we start with?
Well, let's start wearing some green here, young men, at St. Patty's Day with the Dearborn Symphony Orchestra. That's Friday night at 8 p.m. at the Ford Community and Performing Arts Center. We've got Jonathan Lash, baritone extraordinaire, along with Mary and Patrick Lynch, and lots of Irish music and people wearing the green. It's going to be fun.
Wear green, hear Irish music. What could be better?
Doesn't get any better.
Also this weekend, the Detroit Symphony Orchestra comes to a neighborhood near you with the William Davidson Neighborhood Concert Series. Dvorak's Rollicking Violin Concerto, played by Ty Murray, terrific violinist, in Southfield, Monroe, and Beverly Hills, Detroit Symphony Orchestra.
I think that's great. They're out in the neighborhood, and people get a chance to just hear the orchestra right down the street.
Dave, spring's almost here, so what's the good news?
Well, the good news is spring is almost here. And it's also the Detroit Spring and Home and Garden Show at Huntington Place in downtown Detroit. That's this Saturday and Sunday. Everything for the home, both inside and out, and admission is free both days at Huntington Place. If you want something for the whole family, there is something for the whole family at the Henry Ford. That's Scooby-Doo Mansion Mayhem, now through April the 9th. The story is there's a jewel-thieving ghost has dodged the police, last seen in the spooky mansion, and kids and grown-ups can kind of help solve the mystery. So it's fun for the entire family, that is, for adults and children, through April 9th at the Henry Ford Museum. Check that out.
Speaking of kids and great art,
Kids
can make great art. That can be shown at the Detroit Institute of Arts. They're going to have their open call through March 23rd for the 2023 Wayne County High School Art Exhibition. The call for entries is on now for young artists throughout the metro region. For Wayne County, it's the Wayne County High School Art Exhibition at the DIA. 70 works of art will be hung. There's always so much to do around the city. Here's more of what's happening ahead. Hope to see you around and have a great weekend.
This week's One Detroit. Thanks for watching. Head to the One Detroit website for all the stories we're working on. Follow us on social media and sign up for our weekly newsletter.
From Delta faucets to Behr paint, Masco Corporation is proud to deliver products that enhance the way consumers all over the world experience and enjoy their living spaces. Masco, serving Michigan communities since 1929. Support for this program is provided by the Cynthia Edsel Ford Fund for Journalism at Detroit Public TV, the Kresge Foundation.
The DTE Foundation is a proud sponsor of Detroit Public TV, among the state's largest foundations committed to Michigan-focused giving. We support organizations that are doing exceptional work in our state. Visit dtefoundation.com to learn more.
Nissan Foundation and viewers like you.